Hello! In today's bug bounty report explained, you will learn how it was possible to exploit blind SSRF vulnerability in Google Cloud. Blind SSRFs often have little to no impact, but this time the researcher was able to exploit it successfully and he got $31,000 for it. Link to his original blog post is in the description. Also, I've recreated the vulnerability and created hands-on labs. You can try them for free using the link in the description. You only have to leave your email. But for now, enjoy the video. Google Cloud Monitoring is a service that allows you to see metrics for your Google Cloud infrastructure. And uptime checks is a functionality that can send a request to your server to check if it's okay and potentially notify if your server is down. Basic settings allow you to choose the protocol, hostname and path of your server's endpoint. So this sounds like a perfect situation to look for SSRF vulnerability. And instances that perform those uptime checks as well work on Google Cloud infrastructure. And as all other virtual machines, they have metadata endpoints on internal IPs. If we could read a response from this endpoint using SSRF vulnerability, we could, for example, steal service account tokens. So impact of such vulnerability would be critical. But to protect against SSRFs, those endpoints require a specific header. This can successfully prevent attacks when the attacker can only control the URL of the request. But it won't prevent SSRFs here. It's because the uptime checks feature allows user to set custom headers. So the researcher tried to request this endpoint and he saw 200 OK response within 2 milliseconds. It was a concrete evidence that the server indeed made the request to the internal IP. But so far, it's only a blind SSRF and we are not able to show any impact here. The question is if we can somehow read the response. And here, another advanced feature of uptime checks comes into play, response validation. You can write a string that you expect to be present in the response. This could be useful, for example, in a situation where your server returns always 200 response code, even for 404 responses. So the easiest way of exfiltrating data using such functionality looks like this. We have a part of the response that we know. In this case, let's assume it's a beginning of JSON that looks like this. And when you tell the uptime checks feature that you expect this to be present in your response, it's always true because it's always in the response. But what if we try to search for such string with A as the first letter of the actual access token? If the uptime check fails, it means that the access token doesn't start with A letter. So then you try with letter B, C, D, and so on. And finally, you hit a match, let's say with letter E. So now your known part of the response is one character bigger. So now you try the same with the access token that starts with EA, EB, EC, and so on and so forth. You go over and over again until you exfiltrate the whole token. That's basically how blind SQL injection is being exploited. This way, the researcher was able to exfiltrate some data, but unfortunately, not all of it. Because there was a small problem. Uptime checks are performed from different instances all over the world. There were about 54 of them, and each of them has unique access token. So if your uptime check fails, you don't know if you just tried incorrect character or if you just hit another instance. In fact, with 54 instances, the chance of hitting another instance is much, much higher than hitting the one you want to hit. The researcher stopped here, submitted the report and got the reward of $31,000. The next part of the video is based on the comment from Google itself, who tried to escalate the issue and created a proof of concept that was actually able to steal the access token. One idea is to send 54 requests, then statistically you would hit your instance at least once. But in practice you wouldn't have the guarantee, and with multiple characters this surely wouldn't work well. To solve this problem, you can use positive and negative regular expressions. So in previously mentioned situation, you just sent two filters. Square brackets in regexes indicate a range of characters. For example, AZ in square brackets indicates all lowercase letters. A caret means negative search, so caret AZ matches everything but a lowercase letter. In this example, we are only using the A character, so we don't really need the square brackets, but we will need them in a second. In such case, when you hit a positive regex, it's awesome, you have the next character of the token. In case you don't have the positive match, but you have the negative, it means that this character is not the next in the token, and you have to try B, C, and so on. If you get neither of those matches, you need to send the same request again, because it means that you hit the wrong instance. At the beginning, when you only have a few characters of the token, it's possible that tokens from different machines will have collisions, but we don't care about it, because we don't target a specific instance, but we want to leak any token. According to Google, after about 10 characters, the token gets unique. And statistically, you would need 54 requests to hit the correct instance. This means you would need to send thousands of requests to reveal the whole token. And those access tokens are only valid for 60 minutes, so with rate limiting, it's likely that the token would be expired before you are able to leak it to the end. But we can use regular expressions to speed up this process significantly. First, we can brute force not only the next character, but we can brute force the whole token using wildcards. The dot stands for any character in regexes. So you can use multiple dots to brute force all characters in parallel. This reduces the number of requests significantly. Another useful trick is using binary search. We don't need to check each character one by one, like first A, then B, then C, and so on. Using regexes, we can specify ranges of characters so we can implement binary search. First, we can send such request to determine if the next character is a lowercase letter, uppercase letter, a digit, or any character that can be inside the token. Let's assume it's a lowercase letter. The next step is verifying if the character is within the first or the second half of the alphabet. Then you divide that into further halves until you get to a single letter. This way, you also reduce the number of requests that you have to send to determine each character. Of course, the final exploit must have been really complicated, because you have to combine all those three techniques at once, so positive-negative regexes, binary search, and using wildcards to probe multiple characters at once. This way, the exploit was able to leak the access token within 15 minutes, including rate limiting. I recreated the vulnerability in the lab, so you can try your own skills and you can try writing your own exploit. You can easily run this task using Docker. To receive the instruction, you need to leave your email. If you don't succeed in writing the exploit, visit my Twitter in a few days. I will publish my exploit in a few days. Recreating the vulnerability in a new application is not an easy task, but if many people will be interested, I might do this more often. So let me know in the comments, what do you think about it? And that's it. I think this way of exfiltrating data will also allow exploiting other blind vulnerabilities. Anyway, if you've learned something new today, or you've enjoyed the hands-on labs, leave a like under this video, or maybe even buy me a coffee. For now, thanks for watching and goodbye.